morning and a warm welcome to our service. Reverend Matt is helping today at Abington Church, and our sermon this morning will be given by Sue Pennington, preaching for the first time as our licensed reader. And at the end of the service, we shall have our short meeting to elect the second church warden. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And we say together,
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Confess our sins to Almighty God.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Collect for the dinner. Merciful God, teach us to be faithful in change and uncertainty, that trusting in your word and obeying your will, we may enter the unfailing joy of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now we have our first reading to be given by Ruth.
The first reading comes from St. Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 2, beginning to read at the first verse. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully maltreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Now, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them this question: "What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he?" They said to him, "The son of David." He said to them, "How is it then that David by the Spirit calls him Lord, saying, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet'? If David thus calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one was able to give him an answer, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Lord, we thank you for the gift of your word, and as we think on these things, open our hearts and minds to hear you. Amen. I love chocolate. To anyone who really knows me, that would not be an unexpected statement. But only particular makes of chocolate, and certainly not the expensive designer chocolates, just Maltesers and Galaxy. Other makes of confectionery are available, of course. I also love my daughter and my grandchildren. I love sunny days, beaches, mountains, and new places to explore. I also quite like my neighbours, but I do love living where I do, and I'm very lucky to be in a community of people who keep an eye on each other without being intrusive. So many meanings to love. If we're fortunate, we can experience love many times in our lives, but what does love look like? Is it the heart-stopping, all-enveloping feeling that we have when we see our baby for the first time? That fierce, protective instinct when you know that you would lay down your life for that child? Or is it that mouth-watering anticipation before you place that small, round ball of chocolate, malt, and honeycomb into your mouth? Is it that feeling of peace and awe when you walk into your church building and feel God is reaching out to you from every stone? As we heard from Rosie earlier, the final sentence of the passage from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 2, marking his ministry in Thessalonica, reads, "Because we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well." Another reading in the lectionary for today is from Leviticus, chapter 19. Verse 18 states, "Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." So much about love. C.S. Lewis identified four types of love. Storge. Storge might also be called affection or familial love. This word isn't used in the Bible, but the concept is there. Storge is based on familiarity. A person will love their family, normally, regardless of whether they are people the person would be drawn to otherwise. Eros. Eros is romantic love. Eros also isn't a word that appears in the Bible, although it plays a major role in a lot of Old Testament problems. Philia. Philia is friendship love. Philia occurs from bonding over similar interests. Friends, of course, care about one another, but it is similar interests that attract them to one another. Agape. Agape could be defined as charity. However, we often think of charity nowadays as giving away money or things, which doesn't encompass all of what agape is about. Agape is unconcerned with the self and concerned with the greatest good of another. It isn't born out of emotions, feelings, familiarity, or attraction, but from the will and as a choice. Agape requires faithfulness, commitment, and sacrifice without expecting anything in return. This is the type of love the Bible speaks about the most. The New Testament references agape over 200 times. In this passage from Matthew, it is 3 days before the crucifixion and Jesus is in the temple teaching. The last few weeks have shown lots of skirmishes between Jesus and his opponents, all leading up to this battle of words, which will ultimately culminate in his death. He has been asked about whether they should give taxes to Caesar, as we heard from Matt last week. Then more questions to do with the resurrection, both contentious subjects to try and trap him. Now, the greatest commandment. Jesus is a strong character. You can sense that in Matthew 22, he is getting frustrated with these people trying to catch him out, now with a question of law. Jesus rarely spoke of these things directly. He told parables, which were sometimes so complicated, he then had to explain them to his followers. He was direct, unflinching, even against some of the country's most brilliant lawyers and rabbis. He had absolute certainty that God's way, and therefore his way, was the right way. The question about which was the greatest commandment would have been one debated frequently and thoroughly amongst the rabbis, and Jesus' view would not have been so different to those of his contemporaries. The first passage that Jesus cites, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind," is taken directly from Deuteronomy 6 and is the central and best known text of Judaism. The Shema Yisrael, meaning "Hear, O Israel," is a Jewish prayer and is also the first two words in a section of the Torah, and is the title of a prayer that serves as a centerpiece of the morning and evening Jewish prayer service. Observant Jews consider the Shema to be the most important part of the prayer service in Judaism, and its twice daily recitation is seen as a religious commandment. This question that the Sadducees asked was answered clearly, but Jesus then went on to expand, giving them the second most important commandment as well: love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus then gives us a guide for interpreting the whole law. All the law and prophets hang on these two commandments. In other words, anyone who follows these two commandments wholeheartedly will always be doing right in the eyes of God, and the whole law of Moses and the teachings of the prophets depend on these two commandments, not on the lawyers and rabbis, who are generally making it all about themselves rather than God. The whole law, summarized in two commandments, revolving around one word, love. It all sounds so easy, doesn't it? So wonderfully straightforward. Or at least it does, until we realize that the neighbors Jesus refers to are not just those who live next door or nearby, but everyone, anywhere. It is easy to feel overwhelmed by the scale of the task and the enormity of the responsibility. Far from reducing the challenges that God places upon us, this suddenly intensifies them. For instead of giving us a list of things not to do, it challenges us to explore what we are able to do. The list is endless, for there is virtually no limit to the human need within our world. In our own society and beyond, there is a multitude crying out for support and help, desperately in need of some kindness and compassion. We cannot, of course, respond to them all, and Jesus would not have expected us to do that, but we can always do something. Faith begins with God's love for us and our love for him in response, but it cannot end there, for whenever our neighbour is in need, God is in need too. It is an amazing gift for us. He is saying, when you love and serve your neighbour, it is as if you were loving and serving Jesus himself. Imagine for a moment that Jesus was arriving here in Western Fable for a quick visit. He would come to church, be seated, physically distanced, of course, but would he be let in if he hadn't pre-booked? No refreshments, of course, at this time, but I'm certain he would be invited to someone's house for a meal if the numbers weren't more than six. We would consider it the highest privilege of our lives to receive and care for him. What though if it was a rough sleeper that arrived at our church, or maybe one of our neighbours whose house was definitely not kept in the best condition, whose clothes and body certainly looked unkempt? How welcoming would we be then? We would probably be quite thankful for social distancing, for the fact that there was no coffee after the service, and then we would all be remarkably busy and unable to stay and chat or provide a meal. How do we know that the rough sleeper or the unkempt neighbour isn't Jesus? It is only through having the Holy Spirit in us and working through us that we can hope to love the way that God wants us to. It is by faith in God supplying the gift of the Holy Spirit to bring us to that real loving relationship with God and our fellow man. Can we, as Christians, learn to love and affirm one another better, especially the most wounded and vulnerable among us? In Proverbs chapter 16, verse 24, it reads, "Gracious words are like a honeycomb, sweet to the soul." We're almost back to Maltesers again. We may need to take the focus away from ourselves and look outside our immediate communities, our families, and friends. Jesus was full of love. He came to serve, to care for the vulnerable, to take care of all those around him, whoever they were. By basing our lives in Jesus and the love that we all receive from God, we root ourselves in love. We may have had dark times in our lives when we have experienced a lack of love, but God will meet us in that dark place and journey with us so that we can forgive ourselves and others and start again. We can start by loving our neighbour, loving whoever is in our community, loving one another. And as we do this, we begin to know God and discover that we are known and loved by him. Lord, show me how to love those you place around me, just where I am. Show me that it is in loving others that I will find you, and in finding you, come to know you. Amen.
Stand and declare what we believe. We believe in God.
We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named. We believe in Jesus, God's Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Now, Ginny will lead us in prayer.
In love and trust, let us pray to our God. Holy God, give us the courage to tell your truth without fear, to work for your kingdom with joy. Thank you for the support and love of other Christians, the richness of our varied traditions. May we focus our attention on you with such love that all unnecessary divisions between us crumble. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, we pray for our rulemakers, that our laws work to uphold what is just and true. We pray that we may live in godly peace and goodwill through choice, rather than through fear of punishment, through the desire to live well, rather than avoiding detection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, may we replace conflict, jealousy, deceit with courage and truthfulness. May we provide shelter, love, support and care, encouragement for one another with humility. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, we pray for patience and understanding for those to whom breaking the law and behaving badly is a way of life. We pray for those in prison, those returning to life outside, that those working to support and care for them will be blessed with the gift of seeking out their talents, needs, and desires. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, we pray for the sick, those trapped by physical frailty, illness, paralysis. Send your Holy Spirit to walk alongside them, those recovering from surgery, those going on for further treatment, and a long road to recovery. May your Holy Spirit shine bright beams of light and hope into their dark places of fear and anxiety. Guide their medical teams as they strive to achieve recovery for their patients. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Father, as we give thanks for their lives, we pray for those who have died, for those who ache with sorrow at their going. In the quiet, we name them in our hearts. Give all who grieve comfort during this time, scarred by the difficulties brought about by the pandemic. May your Holy Spirit walk beside them in the coming days and time to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, be with us during the next few weeks as we seek a new incumbent. May we listen and discern, putting your Son, our Saviour, and in the midst of our community. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand. We come now to our restrained peace. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, says the Lord, there am I in the midst of them. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We share the peace. please. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours.
All that is from you, and of your home do we give you.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, 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 holy Lord. God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me.
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
And we say together,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith with thanksgiving. say together the prayer after communion.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
A reminder that next Sunday evening at 6 p.m. is our annual memorial service. And if you'd like to add names, please send an email or message to the office by Wednesday, please. The harvest appeal has gone very well. With gift aid, it's about 2,350, marvellous. Rosemary Pastel, who's organising it, who's not a well lady at present, it would be really nice if we could perhaps get that up to 2,500. So if you've not yet made an offering, that would be very acceptable. Made up a PCC marked harvest. By Tuesday of this week. Now then, it's time to have our short meeting, and John Faz, the late chairman of the PCC, will now take over.
Thank you, Michael. Joy Maxwell has asked me to chair this meeting. Are you happy that I do so?
Yes.
I'm asked Claire Shaw as PCC Secretary to take the minutes. This is a meeting for the election of a church warden to fill a casual vacancy following the resignation of Keith Thomas. Keith would have normally come to the end of his term as church warden at the annual meeting that was due to be held in April this year. But COVID intervened. He felt it right, however, that someone else took on the role to help during the vacancy, and he subsequently stepped down, thereby creating what is known as a casual vacancy. Joy, as convener of the meeting, has received just one nomination to fill this vacancy. This is Phil Norris, who has been proposed by John Baxter and seconded by Claire Pearce. I would therefore ask you now to vote for this proposal. All those in favour, raise your hand. Any against? I therefore have pleasure in declaring that Phil Norris has been elected as church warden. Thank you. Thank you for your attendance, and I now declare this meeting closed.
That's the sort of meeting I like.
So do I.
The blessing. You are called and loved by God the Father, and kept safe by Jesus Christ. Mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.